Hey, good morning, everyone. I'm Alan Lewis. I'm responsible for the technology enabling the U.S. Department of State's medical program. We provide primary preventative and emergency health care to U.S. government employees and their families stationed at diplomatic posts all over the world. We have over 200 clinics in 170 countries with 1,500 staff caring for 70,000 patients. We maintain emergency medical kits and countermeasures, deploy protective medicine providers to austere and high-risk environments, provide specialized medical transport, and run comprehensive lab, pharmaceutical, and mental health programs. Today, I'm going to tell you a story of digital transformation. Chapter one. During the COVID pandemic, while most of the world quarantined, we shifted to 24/7 operations and executed over 600 missions, costing nearly $300 million. These missions included repatriation of US citizens, distributing protective and test equipment, medically evacuating patients, and ultimately delivering and administering the vaccine to every post. We did all of this rather inelegantly on unstructured and unnormalized spreadsheets and PowerPoint slides. After I sat on the early task force in the middle of the night and edited this multi-leg flight itinerary across three time zones in Excel that you see here, I reached out to Palantir for help. When we surveyed our operations, we realized we were making decisions on an incomplete understanding of our information environment. These decisions in the middle of a contingency or crisis are under significant time pressure with lives on the line. Thus, we were accepting risks to our mission and to our force that we were unaware of because we couldn't compile all the variables in time. In total, we found 30 use cases for data aggregation, analytics, and process automation. Today, that program has 60 production applications for the end-to-end lifecycle of our emergency medical program and every functional domain of our broader operations. We can manage clinical credentials, proactively identify threats or events that we need to respond to, plan and track all of our training and operations, and allocate resources in a data-informed manner. Now, when strikes are reported near a nuclear facility in Ukraine, we can immediately ascertain how many iodine tablets are in Kyiv. Chapter two. In 2023, more than a decade after the majority of US healthcare systems had adopted electronic health records, we were still documenting all of our clinical encounters on paper. Pictured here is a small fraction of former employee charts that are stored for up to 30 years in a warehouse. Every time a current employee moves, they hand carry their chart to the new post. Meanwhile, the third attempt over 15 years to deploy our own electronic health record faltered. I took over the project and concluded that one of the fundamental issues we were facing is that commercial EHRs are designed to optimize billing and insurance. We do neither of those things. Additionally, we have highly specialized workflow, such as helping employees with medical conditions identify the right posts equipped to support them. So we decided to build on our Foundry infrastructure to create a bespoke, non-standard EHR with the goals on screen. We put the first application for that into production in 3 months, reducing the time it takes to clear candidates to the Foreign Service from 60 days down to 12. We launched the minimum viable product of the provider portal in under a year, saving $100 million of the taxpayers' dollar. And we recently deployed our first AIP workflow, bringing us from analog to AI in 18 months. Now every single encounter that we do is documented digitally, and new employees to the department will never see a paper chart. Next, I'm going to show you how these two platforms work in conjunction to perform our highest risk mission, a biocontainment medical evacuation of a patient with a highly infectious disease. Starting in Axiom, our enterprise data management platform, a small team of threat analysts monitor emerging epidemiological and kinetic threats near our people, posts, and planes. So for example, when a warehouse in Lebanon explodes, there is a limited amount of time for us to respond and put together a relevant plan. Therefore, we must proactively monitor developing situations around the world, which generates thousands of data points. In this scenario, the system alerts the analysts of multiple infectious disease reports after aggregating various open source feeds, identifying an early outbreak near one of our posts. The analyst leverages AIP to broaden their search, allowing them to provide global coverage of these very niche focus areas. After assessing the legitimacy and the severity of these events, we need to rapidly disseminate an easily digestible report to the impacted posts. The report is generated with a proposed analysis that the user can edit, apply the appropriate level of classification, and send out. So now in this scenario, the nearby health unit receives this report, and they'll step up precautionary measures and screening in response. Now at the health unit, our patient, Jane, presents with flu-like symptoms, and the staff is able to quickly pull up the patient's chart. Now we're gonna document this clinical encounter. I'm gonna state the obvious here, but only one person can possess a physical chart at any given time. We're demonstrating this behind me sequentially, but in practice, the admin staff can update the demographics while the nurse documents vitals, updates immunization records, and logs the chief complaint, all while the provider conducts the remainder of the encounter. This is an improvement to the patient experience, the administrative efficiency of the visit, and it's crucially important in maintaining accountability, security, and integrity of the patient's record. I also want to point out that my team working on these encounters was six people, none of whom come from a technical background, and Palantir didn't actually build them. What we built was a tool that normalizes clinical encounters into their base components that are then added and arranged to create a multitude of encounter types, and my clinicians did most of the configuration. At the end of the encounter, a lab test is ordered. The health unit's inventory, which is maintained in Axiom, is checked to make sure that the equipment is available and the expendable items for the test are ready so that only available tests can be ordered. Now the lab technician scans the results to be extracted and loaded into the patient's record. As this information is pulled out, the system checks against a list of ordering providers to pair the result to the open encounters. Known labs, also tracked in Axiom, are identified, and critical or abnormal results are automatically flagged. Time manually entering results is saved, and human error is minimized. The provider then consults Axiom's medical capabilities information application to find a preferred host nation resource for additional testing that's unavailable in the health unit. These external labs would be uploaded and processed similarly to the internal lab. Now, a week later, Jane returns, worse condition, with new symptoms, and she discloses travel to the outbreak area identified in the original report. We make a referral to our infectious disease specialist in DC, who now with this capability can review the chart and all the lab results in real time with the consulting provider. The specialist deems Jane a patient under investigation and recommends immediate medevac. Now the provider is initiating a medevac from the portal. This sends all of the required information to coordinators across a multitude of functions to begin planning. The full chart, patient's history, all previously inaccessible, are securely shared with our air ambulance vendor to ensure continuity of care throughout their trip. Historically, we had to make a trade-off here between insecurely transmitting patient information or excluding potentially pertinent information that the provider needs. Sometimes this meant taping a physical copy of the records to the patient's chest on their way out. After planning the itinerary, 6 hours later, the aircraft is en route to evacuate Jane. The aviation operation is tracked live to enable real-time coordination and communications with the receiving hospital and other stakeholders. Now Jane is safely back in the United States to receive care at a specialty facility. This generates substantial records that exist outside of our platform. When there's a delay in uploading this external care, the post provider does not know or has to rely on the patient to know what occurred, such as new medications. They can't safely adequately address complications upon return with this delay. Now, with minimal manual entry, we can use AIP to tag, index, and parse any paper record generated outside of our practice to become part of the chart before they return to post. We use upstream data sources, such as medication lists from our e-prescription service, to set boundaries on AIP so that only structured, cleaned, and vetted data is presented to the user for addition to the chart. In the next chapter, we plan to deploy a patient portal by the end of this year, built entirely in Foundry to 50,000 users. In parallel, we're developing our next round of AIP use cases, such as scheduling and ambient clinical intelligence, to match or surpass a Western standard of care for all of our patients, regardless of what corner of the world they're serving the country in. That's the story of how we're improving at saving lives, leveraging Foundry and AIP. Thanks for listening.